This Macintosh Classic II from 1991 already consumed some of my time for doing a full capacitor swap out to fix the checkerboard syndrome, only to find out, this time over, the SCSI hard drive has seen its final time. The only question is, how complicated can it be to replace the failed hard drive with this SCSI2SD adapter? Retrocomputing is the use of older computer hardware and software in modern times. I'm the Vintage Collector, and these are my stories. As I mentioned, I had already done some restoration work on this machine at an earlier stage, though I failed to do any video documentation on this behalf. When I got this machine, it featured the infamous checkerboard syndrome. In the end, I went down the route to remove the capacitors. As you can see on my actual close-up images, there was quite some spill onto the main logic board from the leaked capacitors. I did some thorough cleaning and recapped the entire logic board after I had submerged it into an alcohol bath overnight. And after setting up everything from scratch again, I just recently found that the hard drive had died. So here I have a SCSI2SD adapter. It's an older version 5 model that I was given for experimenting with. As it sat in a drawer for quite a while, I wonder if I now can put it to some use for fixing this Macintosh Classic system. For the SCSI2SD adapters, you need to download a specific software package to apply the configuration. While it should run out of the box without any such configuration, I was to double down on the settings to see if things are alright. I'm about to use a 120MB microSD that's about the smallest I could find. The Macintosh Classic II came with either a 42 or an 85MB SCSI hard drive. Accordingly, I will set the settings on the firmware to read as follows. SCSI ID 0, maximum size of 85MB with a vendor ID of Quantum and the device ID reading PI08S026. This will give away some storage space, but limits the overall capacity for a period correct 85MB. For the system installation, the hard drive must be prepared. I used the stock System 7.1 Disk Tools floppy to begin with, only to find that it was picky about the drive not being recognized. Some online investigation later, I found this was a known and common problem, as Apple hardcoded their devices into the software, so it would not work with any non-blessed third-party hardware. Luckily, there is patches available for the Apple HTSE utility. My only problem was that I have no other machine of this era available, so how would I be able to patch the utility? Help came in form of the Basilisk 2 emulator, which I used for setting up a virtualized System 7.1. Using the emulated system, I could then swap over the patched HTSE utility onto the disk image that I had previously pulled off my original 7.1 utility disk. Then I transferred the altered image back to the spare floppy disk, from which I then booted the Mac. Lo and behold, here we have the patched utility in action, and yes, it recognized my SCSI2SD device and initialized it. We can also see the disk size in this still shot, which indicates the 85MB capacity limit that we previously set in the firmware. From here on, I would then perform another reboot to run through the standard System 7.1 installation procedure. It would take eternities to install the operating system, way over 30 minutes, so let's do some time lapse here. And then, eventually, it boots off the SCSI2SD drive. What a great success! Well, now for bringing software onto the Mac Classic, it becomes a bit more complicated. The reason is that I don't have any other such old machine at hand that I could use to bootstrap from. Also, I don't have any original disk media available, which makes it even more complicated. There's a number of websites where you can download vintage and abandonware software for any such old machines. However, More often than not, they come in STUFFit format and not as disk images. So this means I have to extract these packages as well into my emulated system 7.1 on Basilisk 2 and then repackage it. I do the approach of repackaging as self-extracting STUFFit archives and, where necessary, to segment the packages so they could fit multiple 1.4 MB floppies where needed. My luck that this approach actually works is the fact that the Mac Classic 2 features a 1.44 MB floppy drive, which uses the same fixed rotational speed as the PC counterparts. Would it have been an 800 kilobytes or a 400 kilobytes floppy drive, I'd be essentially lost, as there is no way to write these floppy images from a PC due to their variable speed characteristics. But like so, I could eventually pack up a few games and transfer them over to the Macintosh Classic. But wait, there would have been some other options to investigate as well. First, I could have hooked up a SCSI iOmega SIP drive to the Mac and used this for file transfer. But I have only the parallel port SIP drives available, so this option is currently out for me. Secondly, you remember that I artificially limited the disk space allocation to 85 MB on the SCSI2SD adapter. Technically speaking, what it does is to allocate the disk image file on the SD card of 85 MB in size. I could have tried mounting this in Basilisk 2 and transfer the files over into the disk image directly. Maybe that would have worked as well, but is open to further investigation. The third option would have been to use a network, being that parallel or serial connections between two Macs. I have several Macs available, though the oldest so far is an iMac from 2001, which is considered legacy-free. Sure, maybe I could use a USB to RS-232 adapter on the iMac side, but still I would require a DIN to RS-232 cable for the Mac Classic, which I didn't have at hand. But frankly, that's an option that I will eventually investigate, as I use serial and parallel transfer all the time for transmitting files between DOS PCs, just to spare the efforts of being a floppy disk jockey. In the meantime, I had some games transferred and installed onto this machine and… Oh, actually I should not waste my time right now playing Prince of Persia, should I? I still remember playing this some 30 years ago on the Macintosh of my godfather. But I should really focus on wrapping things up now. So to say, wrapping it up means also to properly mount the SCSI2SD adapter into the 3.5-inch hard drive caddy. My brother-in-law stepped in again to print me this mounting bracket for the adapter. And with this put in place, it looks very nice and tidy already. And this concludes my restoration of the Macintosh Classic II. It was the first time ever I had used a SCSI2SD adapter. It went without much surprises, as it's very well documented. Also, I didn't expect too many problems with it in the first place, as I had already done several IDE to CF replacements in other machines. The only odd thing is the software support from Apple's side, which seemed to hardcode and limit their HDSC setup utility to a limited amount of known hardware supported. Thank God there was this patch available, so I could overcome this limitation. In the end, I'm 100% sold on the SCSI2SD approach as well, and I will definitely consider to replace the hard drive on this SGI Indie. But that's a topic for another time and another video. If you like this video, then please Consider to subscribe. See you next time.